engaging and identifying as a transgender person is self-destructive behavior. Everything you do is about self-destruction. You're changing your name. You're putting stuff in your body that doesn't belong there. You're cutting body parts off. This is all Frankenstein-like stuff. And the fact is that no one in the history of mankind has ever changed their gender. It's never happened. Right. No one actually in the history of mankind has ever actually transitioned. This idea about becoming your true self is actually false. You're becoming your phony self. They can't make a vagina. They can't turn you into a woman. All they can do is they actually take your penis and turn it outside in. Everybody who identifies as a transgender, they're trying to destroy themselves. It was never about gender dysphoria. It was about some underlying comorbid disorder. The truth is there's not one person on planet Earth that needs to rearrange their genitalia.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. And today's episode of the Dr. J Show, I have my friend Walt Heyer as our returning guest. He spoke with us about a year ago, and he was also a speaker at last year's Summit for Survivor of the Sexual Revolution. He was such a hit at last year's summit that we've invited him to come back and be a guest again this year. And not only that, we're going to give him the Public Witness of the Year Award. So you want to find out what it's all about? Tune in now to hear us talk with Mr. Walt Heyer. Walt, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Yeah, thank you. It's a pleasure to be back. An honor.
Yes. Well, we're honored to have you too. Last year was a little bit of a, I don't know, comedy of errors, but it all fell together like it was providential or something.
Yeah.
That you should be the guy at our event. So that was great.
Fantastic. I enjoyed it.
Well, so for people who are not familiar with your story, you're one of the first people to attempt to live as the opposite sex and then to walk it back. Tell people a little bit about your story, just in rough outlines, Walt.
Yeah, well, quickly, you know, my journey started, I don't look it, but I'm 81 years old. And so...
You're what?
81 years old.
You're 81 years old? Oh, wow. And no, you don't look it.
And so I started my cross-dressing journey in 1944 at the age of four. And so my grandmother made me a purple chiffon dress. And from that purple chiffon dress, she was affirming me, telling me how cute I was. It was our little secret. Kept that from my parents because she didn't want her parents to know what she was, my parents to know what she was doing. And so what I learned from that is quite interesting, though. When you put a boy in a dress, you're telling him there's something wrong with him as a boy.
Right.
And you don't really realize that at the time it's happening. These things, these revelations come to you 30 or 40 years later that, you know, there's psychological and emotional harm being caused by putting a boy in a dress and telling him he looks cute or whatever. And so in my case, that psychological harm, when my dad did find out that grandma was cross-dressing, his mother-in-law, isn't that fascinating? What is the mother-in-law cross-dressing my son? That's going to get some action.
Right.
So he decided that he was going to shape me and mold me with a hardwood floor plank through discipline. So he began to use discipline of a hardwood floor plank rather than just scolding me or something, because he was frustrated with his with my grandmother cross-dressing me. So had it not been for the purple dress, I never would have been hit with a hardwood floor plank. It never would have happened. And so the next extension to that was his adopted brother, Fred, decided to sexually molest me. All this happened before I was 9 years old. So there was a cross-dressing, which is child abuse, by the way, cross-dressing a boy and telling me he can be a girl or inferring that he can, is psychological and emotional child abuse. Hardwood floor plank is physical abuse, and then suffered the sexual abuse. And all before I was before 1950. So, you know, we didn't have cell phones. We didn't have any terminology or words at that time. I just knew that I was starting life out a little on the rough side. And so I had to cope and deal with those things on my own. And obviously I didn't know how to do that. Right. And then I heard about Christine Jorgensen, which I think came off in the mid 1950s. They blazoned the headlines, a soldier changed, became a transsexual. That was the word that they used back in those days. Had undergone surgery. And I thought, well, that must be me. That was my identifier, not knowing really what that meant. They didn't say that Christine Jorgensen was an alcoholic and had a lot of issues, psychological and emotional issues. They just talked about the fact that this person changed into a woman, which actually today we know he never changed into a woman. He's still a he. He passed away. But so.
But how old were you when that hit the scene? And when you.
I was probably 14.
I see. When that came into your mind, oh, this is the path for me.
Yeah, it must be who I am. I think that mm-hmm. was something for me to connect with because I couldn't put it with anything before then. So, and then I went through the rest.
So if I could just pause sure. you right here. Yeah. Age 14 is the age that a lot of children are making these decisions now. And so all of you listeners, I just want you to think about what it means for a 14-year-old to grab on to this solution to their problem. And, you know, how many 14-year-olds do you know who are really capable of making life-determining decisions like that? Yeah. So, yeah.
Excellent point. And I can tell you that a 14-year-old can't make life-changing
decisions. No, is it right? People, this is an IQ test. Yeah. If you're not sure. Yeah. Yeah. No, 14-year-olds can't make that type of judgment. Yeah. So anyway, continue.
And that's why I'm testifying today at 81 years old. I can tell you that it doesn't work, but you do get, you're impressed upon as though that something can happen. And so I went on and struggled with this. I never had same-sex attraction. I was never homosexual. That was never an issue with me. I had an identity issue caused by sexual abuse, physical abuse, and emotional abuse by 3 members of my family. So I went on, got married, had children, still struggled. I told my wife at the time that I was struggling with this issue. And we both thought that, you know, getting married would solve it. And we thought this would solve it and that would solve it. Having children would solve it. Having a good career, which I worked on the Apollo space missions as an associate design engineer, had a great career. I was doing quite well. But that didn't solve it. I went on to the auto industry and became an executive for American Honda Motor Company. I thought that would solve it. It didn't. I began to drink heavily, trying to cope with being physically, sexually, and emotionally abused as a child. We don't understand that these things, if we don't resolve what happened early in life, they're going to persist until something happens. Right. And so, right. you know, today I understand there's a term called adverse childhood experiences, and that's really what happens to the young people who go through this. I was suffering from adverse childhood experiences.
Yeah, you racked up quite a few. You racked up quite a few there, Walt, just in your short description there of what you described.
Absolutely. Right. So I went to one of those gender specialists when I was working at Honda because I had a lot of money, and I went to the number one guy. In fact, this guy, if you know the WPATH standards of care, yes. and he was the original author of those standards. So he was that well-respected that he could author those standards with some other people, of course. And so he was my therapist in San Francisco on Union Street. And I met with him and he said, oh, well, you have gender identity disorder, but he said they're actually going to change it to gender dysphoria because it's a much more appropriate diagnosis. He knew that in 1981 and it didn't.
So in 1981, you were allowed to say, disorder. But he knew that the word disorder was going to go away and be replaced with bad feelings, dysphoria. You feel bad and that's the problem.
And he admitted that they were trying to get it changed to make it easier for people to transition and that he was part of the team trying to get that done. So that didn't mean anything to me at the time, right. but upon reflection, you can see how disastrous that is. So you know, he said that what you need then is hormone therapy and gender reassignment surgery. And he said, you got to come back and we'll. And I told him about my childhood history. I told him about the abuse, physical and sexual. And he said, well, it really doesn't matter. You have a condition that's only going to get resolved with hormones and surgery. And it kind of thought, well, that's really, you know, and I had no context for anything. I mean, I'm primarily an engineer. I helped develop the Acura division for Honda. I don't have context for the psychological side of things. I'm a nuts and bolts kind of person.
Right, right.
So I said, okay. And he put me on, he gave me approval to get hormones. I went on the hormones. 1983, I underwent gender reassignment surgery by Dr. Stanley Biber in Trinidad, Colorado. Stanley Biber, at the time he did my surgery, had performed some 3,200 of these procedures. He was one of the
3,200? By 1983, there was already 3,200 of these procedures?
That he had done.
Wow.
That he had personally, he was doing 4 and 5 a week and had been for years.
And just to be clear, people, you might be a little squeamish here, but gender reassignment surgery for a man in that context means what exactly?
Yeah, that means they refashion your genitalia to make a pseudo. They can't make a vagina. They can't turn you into a woman. All they can do is they actually take your penis and turn it inside, outside in. So you still have your penis. You don't actually lose it. They use everything that's there. They just invert it. So the idea that you lose your penis is not accurate.
Is that still what they do?
Some of the people do. I think there's different procedures that people use. Different surgeons have different procedures. I think that's primarily what they do. Dr. Bowers in California uses that procedure. Bowers is Mark Bowers, who identifies as Marcy Bowers, was trained by Dr. Biber. And so Bowers does this procedure, makes about $1,300,000 a year doing the procedures.
Wow. And so that's the surgery part. And then there's the whole hormonal part, which goes along with it.
Right. So then you're on hormones. You're on pretty heavy doses of hormones before you have the surgery. Then that regimen changes. I've actually forgotten what it was because it's been 35 years ago, but you reduce the amount of hormones you take and then you're kind of on your way, but you're on hormones the rest of your life, basically, until you reach my ripe old age. And then they're kind of worthless, but you know, male or female, I haven't been on even male hormones for a long time. I don't take any hormones at my age.
Okay.
So yeah, that just goes.
Okay. So that's what happened. I mean, that's just kind of the physicality of what happened.
Exactly.
And then what happened that made you feel that it wasn't working?
Briefly, I lived identifying as Laura Jensen for 8 years. And what I realized was, and I started studying psychology at UC Santa Cruz because I wanted to be a therapist. My idea was to get a PhD, become a therapist, and actually work with people in different clinical environments. But reading the books, I found out that people who identify, the first study that I read was actually, I think, from Cornell University, and a guy who had a mother, he was a single mother with her son, and she passed away. And he identified then as a female, and doing the clinical study with this individual, they realized that he identified as a female to keep his mother alive. In other words, he took on her identity. That's not transgenderism. That's a mental disorder.
Right.
And when I realized that was kind of the first clue, well, wait a minute, there's something much deeper going on. They're not really making females here. They're just helping people in maybe cope, but it's in an inappropriate way by cutting their body parts off to help them cope because now they have other issues and I'm one of those people. So that was sort of the first clue when I read these studies and began to go, wait a minute, there's something that they're not talking about here. So the more I studied this and the more I realized that there are comorbidities, I didn't even know the word comorbidity until I went to school and started studying psychology. And I'm in a class with a bunch of PhDs. I was the only one in the class that didn't have a PhD. And they kind of befriended me. Many of them very helpful. And so I learned a great deal in there about comorbidities and things that happened to people. And I became very interested. Actually got the top grade in the class. I was so excited about that. But so then that was in 89. And by 1990, you know, I'm also working with psychologists. I had been suffering from alcoholism because of my issues in life. And I was coming out of alcoholism and I was working with a psychologist and began to come out of this. And I detransitioned in 1990 back to Walt. Because I was studying psychology, I'd found the Lord Jesus Christ. I was going back to church. I was struggling with all of the things that went on with the history of losing my marriage of 16 years. My children couldn't figure out what the heck Dad was doing. Dad didn't know what he was doing. And I realized, you know, I became, it was a very selfish thing to do. So self-centered, like you may have, the widow, the transgender widow that, you know, my wife was that. And after 16 years,
that term is the trans widow. I've known now enough people like who've been through that situation, you know, that they, you know, they're like looking at, well, what happened to my husband? You know, well, I'm a widow. My husband's alive, but he's not my husband anymore. He's not capable of being my husband anymore. He's not available to me and my children. So what was that like for them? Well, actually, I have to jump to the end. Did you in any way reconcile with your children and
oh yeah, wife? I did. I have a great relationship with my children today. Yeah. Good. So all that's good. I still have a great relationship with my ex-wife. Yeah. But next week I'll be married to my wife Casey for 25 years too. So we've reconciled and recovered and restored a lot of things in my life.
Right, right. Well, that to me, that's the most important thing, is for people to know that restoration is possible, that healing is possible. And if you're watching this because a family member has done the trans thing and you're wondering, you know, what's going to happen? What can I do? Am I ever going to get my dad back? You know, or whatever thoughts might be going through a person's mind. Please know that there is hope. You don't want to obsess about it, I suppose, because you can't control what your loved one does, but to make yourself available and to not give up hope. I think that's a message one can take from Walt's story. I'm sorry, I got you off the track of your.
Oh no, that's right.
Those parts are really important, I think, because people don't realize, you know, when we celebrate somebody finding themselves and becoming their true selves and everything, you never hear about the people who are left behind and the impact that it has on the children that they don't have a dad anymore. Exactly, they all of a sudden have what do I have, two moms here? What's going on? So. Do you mind telling us a little bit about that? For your family members?
Yeah, and this idea about becoming your true self is actually false. You're becoming your phony self when you transition and do these things to your body and everything. Because, you know, what we know, Jennifer, is that engaging and identifying as a transgender person is self-destructive behavior. Everything you do is about self-destruction. You're changing your name. You're putting stuff in your body that doesn't belong there. You're cutting body parts off. This is all Frankenstein-like stuff, you know. And the fact is that no one in the history of mankind has ever changed their gender. It's never happened. Right. No one actually in the history of mankind has ever actually transitioned. You know, that word suggests that something actually happened, that they actually transition from one gender. That never has happened. And what I have found in the people I've worked with, I can only speak to the thousands of people that I've worked with. I haven't found one of them with gender dysphoria. None of them had gender dysphoria. I didn't have gender dysphoria. It was never about gender dysphoria. It was about some underlying comorbid disorder. Sexual abuse is not gender dysphoria. Physical abuse is not gender dysphoria. It doesn't cause gender dysphoria. To assign that terminology to that is actually incorrect. You may have a dysphoria, may not feel comfortable about yourself, but it was because you were hit with a hardwood floor plank. You were cross-dressed. That's not gender dysphoria. It's a dysphoria where you just don't like who you are. And it's not about gender.
Right. It's an identity. Didn't you once call it a personality disorder or something like that? Is that another term for it?
It can be a personality disorder. It can also be body dysmorphia. It can be schizophrenia, bipolar disorder. You know, all these other things that we now know how to identify. And once we can identify the comorbidity, whatever it is, I mean, there's some people who are addicted to surgical procedures. I ran into a young man I met in Maryland. He had 167, quote, sex change surgeries. Which
I guess the first one didn't work, huh?
Yeah, neither did the 167th one.
Wow. So your thought about that guy is that he was getting he was getting some kind of psychological benefit or some a buzz or something from the repeated surgeries. That was really the object somehow.
It was even more sinister than that. The guy had a horrible childhood and he was trying to destroy himself.
Oh.
And so I think it's important for us to understand that, and we can use that same terminology for everybody who identifies as a transgender. They're trying to destroy themselves. And one of the questions I ask every person that I work with is, why do you want to destroy who you are?
Right.
And so it's a game changer when you ask that question. Why do you want to engage in self-destructive behavior? And that's the second question. The third question is, what happened to you that caused you to not like who you are? Those three questions will every time, you know, it's a great triage question to help people identify why they're behaving the way they're behaving, because it's disordered thinking.
Yes.
You know, and yes. So we know that no one is transgender. We know no one's ever transitioned. So we need to find out what's causing them to not like who they are. Was it sexual abuse, emotional abuse? Some of them had a horrible childhood because the parents were alcoholics or drug addicts. They were passed around, one of them, foster home after foster home. One young lady I worked with had been physically abused, sexually abused by the father for 5 years. Mom never knew it. And so there's things that happen that they won't disclose during a clinical session if one comes about before they engage in the hormone therapy. The truth is there's not one person on planet Earth that needs to rearrange their genitalia. They may need psychotherapy. They may need some help with something to identify what their comorbid disorder is, but they don't need hormones and they don't need surgery. They don't need to change. Nobody should even change their name.
Do you know, as you're talking here, it's really striking me as unbelievably sad that a person has all of these things that have happened to them. And when things are really painful and traumatic, one of the strategies that people use is to avoid the subject of what actually traumatized them. And
absolutely,
we know this from our work with victims of childhood sexual abuse, because the Ruth Institute now has a pretty big footprint in that area, which we got into. We were backed into it. We didn't mean to get into it, but here we are, you know? And what most people want to, it's not uncommon for people to say, let me put this aside. Let me bury this. Let me get rid of it. So I don't have to think about it. Don't have to deal with it. It's so hard, so painful. And it's like the whole, this whole gender clinic industry is all about keeping people from ever looking at those issues.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And when they changed the DSM from gender identity disorder in 2013 and changed it to gender dysphoria, they did that for one reason only. Not, it wasn't done to help better identify the cause. They did it to remove any stigma around having a disorder.
Right.
So the idea that having a disorder is supposed to be bad, actually having a disorder is actually good, because if we can identify it, we can actually treat it. But they don't want
something.
You can do something. And so by doing that, they've caused enormous amount of harm. And
just the missed opportunity, you could say. You know, even if the treatments were completely benign, the fact that you're avoiding dealing with the underlying question is already a problem. And then the treatments aren't benign, right? So you're piling one problem on top of another.
Yeah, and I had a dissociative disorder as a result of being sexually and physically and emotionally abused.
And what is that? Describe, what does that mean?
Well, it didn't rise to the level of being multiple personalities. It's that you dissociated from who you really are to become somebody else, because the pain of being who you are was too horrible. So actually, in many cases, what we have is fantasy for some people looks much better than the real life pain that you're suffering. So once I began to learn about and then started the website, sexchangeregret.com, I wondered, gee, am I the only one in the world that ever regretted this? And so we started the website about a dozen years ago. And I think the first year we had 750 people just looked at the website. By 2015, we had 356,000 views to the site. Today, I have over 10,000 emails in my inbox.
Oh, wow. Wow. You people wanting help in one way or the other.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about how this process has changed since you became Laura and then went back to being Walt. You have a very specific story that you're telling, and it's understandable why a child would want to find some other way of dealing with what all they were dealing with. What are the reasons that kids today are taking on that label? Are they similar to your reasons? Are there different things in play today?
I think there are a certain group of people that had similar experiences that I did, because I still get those. But I think it's changed a great deal. Today, we're actually making institutionalized child abuse by giving kids instruction in public schools, TVs, internet, and every place else on how to change your gender. And to me, the most hideous part of that is that no one's ever changed their gender. It's not possible to change your gender. You can change your persona if we want to be accurate. Anyone can change their persona. You can have 50 different personas. You can have 150 different personas. You can only have one gender. And they've made this score because they came up with this term, what gender were you assigned at birth? Well, that's insane. You know, it was innate and fixed at conception 9 months before you're born. So the reason they used terminology, what gender were you assigned at birth, was simply because if they assigned it at birth, then they can change it afterward.
Correct. Correct.
And that's the only reason. Yeah, that's the only reason they use that. So they've got all these terms that they've used, gender dysphoria, which, as I said, when I work with somebody, I find out even the latest one that I had, which is going to be a medical malpractice case in California, he said, I never had gender dysphoria. They cut off my genitals. They gave me hormones. The guy was suffering from schizophrenia, bipolar 1 disorder, and PTSD. And he had been under the same doctor's care for 12 years.
So the doctor knew all that. The doctor
he knew
had
all
to have known all that.
Oh, yeah. We have all the records. That's why it's a medical malpractice case.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Many possibilities arise there.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, 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 yes. So some of the kids, like, for example, we read about rapid onset gender dysphoria, where it seems like young people are going on the internet, they're getting in these chat rooms, and there's a kind of peer pressure that develops. And parents are reporting in their teenage daughter, who never had any thought of being, who was a girly girl, you know, who was never a tomboy even, now all of a sudden she thinks she's a boy. That sounds like a different process than the one you're describing, because these kids seem to have okay parents. You know, they don't, I don't think they're all getting beat up with sticks, you know, and have the same kind of trauma that you're having. There's another process at work there.
I don't buy rapid onset gender dysphoria.
Really?
At all.
About that.
Yeah.
Okay.
I do buy social contagion.
Oh, I see what you mean. I see what you mean.
They don't have gender dysphoria.
Explain this to people. Okay. Explain your distinction here.
Yeah. Social contagion is they're just doing what their friends are doing. None of these people would fall under a category of actually having a bona fide gender dysphoria. They join these chat groups and they all decide, well, they're going to identify as a guy, or mostly they're girls that do this. And there's four or five of them. They don't have gender dysphoria. It's not rapid onset gender dysphoria. It's rapid onset, you know, social contagion. They're all doing this. And I've worked with some of these young people, 13, 14, 15 years old, with their parents. And in talking with them, I've had them detransition on the spot in a discussion with their mother. When I ask them, why are you doing this? Who's influencing you? They never had gender dysphoria. Mm-hmm. They did it because they're friends. So I think we're doing a disservice by using the term rapid onset gender dysphoria, because gender dysphoria actually gives too much credibility to the left in being able to apply that to giving them hormones and surgery. Keep in mind, gender dysphoria, or dysphoria that has to do with your gender of any kind, means that they can give you hormone blockers and perform surgery on you. So I am absolutely against using the terminology, because no one needs hormones and no one needs surgery. So I would prefer to call it a social contagion. And that doesn't require doing hormone blockers and surgery.
Yes. And so they're similar to your case in that they didn't need hormone blockers and surgery, but they're different from you in as far as the reason that they might have thought that they did, right? They right. get there by a different path.
Yeah, and I'm real good friends with a person who's a coach at a university, and the girls, yeah, she's a woman's helping with the soccer team. And what she's found out is that these people identify as lesbian or transgender or stuff while they're in school. As soon as they leave school, they're not doing it anymore.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it was just a social contagion.
Yeah, I've heard that lesbians until graduation.
Yeah.
That's actually a thing.
Yeah. So,
but to call yourself a lesbian is not nearly as dangerous and not nearly as risky as calling yourself trans, because you can do irrevocable harm to your body.
Well, these lesbians that she's dealing with are identifying as trans, you know, they're trans.
Yeah, they're
also
going that path. They're going down that path.
So
let's talk about the people who are promoting this stuff. The people who are promoting the idea that you can change the sex of the body. Do you have a sense, Walt, of what those people are thinking and what's in it for them? Why are they, you know, why are they so keen on this theory?
Well, there's going to be a lot of different viewpoints on that. Mine is what we're engaged in is the onset of Marxism. What is happening is if we can destroy men and women, you know, if you just can eradicate men and women, then you dehumanize everybody through this whole transgender ideology. Then if we can destroy men and women, then we can destroy the foundation of the church, which is built on one man, one woman, and marriage. They're actually trying to destroy that very foundation. Mm-hmm. And if they can destroy that, the family, and we've heard this before, they want to destroy the nuclear family. What better way to destroy the nuclear family than eradicate men and women and make them something other than that? There are several places now where they don't even put men and women on the bathroom doors. I went to one and it said, whatever.
Where was this, Walt? Where was it?
It was in California.
Why am I not surprised?
So I've written a little bit about this Marxism thing and the onset of it. And I've got an article in the Daily Signal about that. And it's creeping in. I've done a documentary movie for the Catholic Church that really spells this out in really great detail. Is called Wolf in Sheep's Clothing 2, The Gender Agenda. Extremely powerful movie. And it shares in detail about Marxism being the end result.
Yeah, Wolf in Sheep's Clothing Part 1, if I'm not mistaken, was Marxism entering the church through kind of social justice types of things, Saul Alinsky type of things. But this is an additional step. Because what it's doing is undermining the body.
Yeah.
And what I like a lot of what you've said, but I would put it a little bit differently. What people are telling us is that our bodies are insubstantial, you know, that there's no substance to the body, and that whether you're male or female, that doesn't mean anything, because fundamentally your body doesn't mean anything. You can switch up your body any way you want, and you're still, that it's okay to do that. So it's a whole attack on our physicality.
Yeah, I've not heard that before. So that's interesting.
Yeah, I call it a Gnostic death cult, actually. You know, okay. I mean, the whole sexual revolution actually is a death cult, as far as I'm concerned. But this is really obvious, you know, that they're destroying people's physical existence. You know, they're going after different aspects of your physicality. But, you know, in the end, it's the body. There's something wrong with the body. It's always the body.
That's interesting, because when the person detransitions, they feel their body is extremely important.
Yeah.
And so they do. I mean, they realize that it was destroyed unnecessarily. They took parts away from me. They, you know, the young man that I'm working with, he says, I'm heterosexual. I wanted to have a family. 90% of the people that I work with are heterosexual.
And would you make this clear to people? I just would love for you to just say this as clearly as possible. You were a grown man when you transitioned, or when you had began all of this surgical stuff. If somebody starts this business before puberty is completed, or even after even at your age, what are their prospects for a normal sex life? What are their prospects for a normal reproductive life?
Zero. You know, once they take all those parts off, you're done.
Yeah.
And so what happens here is you cannot produce a child, which God intended you to do. You know, and I always liken this group to, you know, if they can't kill you in the womb, when you come out of the womb, they're going to change your gender so you can't produce kids anyway. I mean, it's hideous.
Yeah, there is something very dark about the population control people being involved in this stuff.
Absolutely.
Right. I mean, because just as an incidental side effect of this procedure is you won't be able to have any kids. And you're deciding that when you're 14, you know?
Yeah.
So
exactly
you can't have full on sexual relationships. You can't have reproductive relationships. You can't do it. What do you think about these people who say men can get pregnant? And what they really mean is a woman. Obviously, what they mean, the pregnant person is a woman who's done a bunch of stuff to her body that mm-hmm. is short of completely sterilizing her, but she's presenting somehow as a man. How does that happen? What's the physicality of what's going on there, Walt? What did they take away? What did they add?
Well, obviously, they're still women. You know,
right. they still have the uterus. They still have the womb.
Yeah, so they're still women, whether they get in vitro or whether they have, fertilized by a male or however that goes about, they're still women. So we're so caught up in using these terms that the left has bought us into using. I am doing everything I can these days to avoid using their terms. They gave us the dictionary and we bought into it and we use it all the time as though it's real. And
right.
That's why, you know, they're cross dressers. These are just cross dressers who changed their persona. Mm-hmm. They haven't changed anything. Mm-hmm. And to prove that point, the surgeon who did my surgery, I asked him to come to court when I wanted to change my birth certificate back to male and prove to the court in a document that he could actually change a man into a woman. Prove to the court that you actually did that. And I challenged him and the psychotherapist that approved me. And there's a document in Superior Court, San Mateo, California, 1990. And he admits in the court document, the only thing you can do with hormones and surgery is neuter. That's it. Neuter somebody. No change of any gender. Your morphology is the same. So the whole idea, that's where I became so outraged about the terminology that he, the surgeon, admits you can't change somebody's gender. The only thing you can do is neuter them. And the document is on file, I think, on my website.
And he literally said, I can neuter a person, but I can't change their sex.
That's exactly right.
In other words, we're acting on the assumption that we can change people's sexes, but you threaten them with the penalties of perjury. They're not going to perjure themselves and say anything but that you're neutered. You're a neutered man, but you're not a woman.
And there's a clue. They're very clever with words because now they've changed the terminology. It used to be called sex change surgery. Now they call it gender confirmation surgery. So they're also
tell us what that means. What exactly
that means that someone comes to them and says, I'm a female. Well, they're going to confirm that by making a phony vagina or a phony penis. And then you can confirm yourself that way. But we didn't actually change anything. All we're doing is confirming your thinking.
So do you like that terminology? Do you think that terminology is more honest?
No, I don't think there's anything honest about confirmation at all, because you're confirming a delusion.
That's it. You're confirming delusions. It's truthful in that they're not saying, I made you a woman.
Right.
What they are saying, but it's untruthful in that they're saying, I'm confirming, or I've heard the term gender affirming. Confirmation, gender affirming. We're affirming, but what there's a little, like a little asterisk there. That thing we're affirming is false.
Yeah.
Right. Well, and we won't admit that. We won't admit that it's a lie. That
no one in history is biologically changed. No one. And I love saying it because I feel so good about it, because there are no transgenders. They're cross dressers. Mm-hmm. The men who leave their wives are not transgender. They're suffering from autogynephilia mm-hmm. and transvestic fetish disorders. Mm-hmm. So the man who dresses up and leaves his wife and four kids after 20 years can put on women's clothing and look in the mirror and he becomes sexually aroused by what he sees in the mirror. He doesn't need his wife. He doesn't need a man. He doesn't need a woman. He only needs himself in a dress to become sexually gratified by looking at himself in makeup and clothing in the mirror. That's a sexual fetish disorder. And so he's, what he's done is he's having an affair with himself outside of marriage.
Right. And a particularly creepy affair, one might
add. A creepy affair. And then we have the transvestic fetish disorder, which is maybe someone who is caught up with one or two or three pieces of clothing who becomes aroused by those mm-hmm. pieces of clothing. These are all mental disorders.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, Ruth Institute followers, I hope you can see that Mr. Heyer knows what he's talking about, and that this is a person you want to hear more from. And so we want you to come to the Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution, and you can shake his hand and congratulate him and thank him for being a hero. So people who are concerned about this issue, and there are a lot of people now who are concerned. I mean, this issue, I haven't seen it in a long time, Walt, that because it's being taught in the schools, people are starting to wake up and realize that this is a real thing and that this is serious business. And I so often hear people say, oh, the left has finally overplayed its hand. Well, I never want to talk like that because I thought that 10 years ago that they'd overplayed mm-hmm. their hand, and they still, they keep getting away with it and keep getting away with it.
Yeah.
What would you say to people that would motivate them? Can you help us motivate people to get involved on this issue and to, to stop saying, let Joe do it or something.
Yeah. We really need to get people like Biden, who appoints only LGBT or activist people to the administration. We need to, through our elections, get them out of office because they are recreating a world that we just are not going to love to be in. They're really trying to destroy the church. They're trying to destroy every aspect of family. The nuclear family, women, men, they're in total destruction mode and they hold the cards. We need them out of office with new people in there who will honor and glorify Jesus Christ and honor and glorify men and women and make our country stronger based on our faith and on family and children.
And you started at the top. But people could also start at the bottom in the sense of getting involved with your local school board.
Absolutely.
Local public library. Do you get calls from people about those type of issues, Walt?
Oh, yeah. I get them all. Yeah. So, yeah, you bet. But I do think, I've said this many times and people kind of bristle at it, but because they think they need to have their children in schools to fight the issue. I think the
Ooh.
Schools, I've,
Ooh.
I think I've Ooh. Said... For 6 years, take your kids out of school and get them out of there because the schools are ruining our children.
Yeah.
And the schools, public schools are just abhorrent at what they're teaching and destroying our kids.
Well, and you can't use your child as cannon fodder.
No.
It's one thing for us as adults to march in there and fight. But the children shouldn't have to do that. And they need to be protected. And I get that. And I know that a lot of young families are at their limit just taking care of their own kids. And I get that. Bring them home, homeschool them, do what you have to do to protect the children. But grandma and grandpa, you need to go fight at the school board.
Absolutely.
You need to go. Okay, your child, your grandchild is safe. They got him out of the school. And sadly, even some of the religious schools, we hear this sometimes from Catholic mm-hmm. schools, Christian schools, you go fight that school board, but keep your kid out of it.
Yeah, and the more people can be in the school board fighting for the children, the better off we are. We should just overwhelm them with power and speak out. We're going to lose this generation if we don't save it now.
That's right. And, one of the things we're going to do at the Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution is I'm going to do a 15-minute presentation that is a defense of traditional Christian sexual morality that anyone can do, that anyone can give this presentation.
Beautiful.
At the end of the summit, everybody's going to get a flash drive and the slides are going to be on there. The script is going to be on there. You're going to be able to defend your values. And
great.
I think the reason a lot of people don't get involved is they know something's wrong, but they're afraid that something's going to come up that they can't deal with. and then they're going to be flat-footed. Or something's going to come up that they don't want to deal with, like they've got a skeleton in their closet of some kind, right? And that's a real deal killer for a lot of people. So we're trying to help people. That's part of what we're doing at the summit, is equipping an army to get out there and do something about it. Because this is catastrophic. I mean, what's been going on long? It's been going on a long time. I try to tell people that. The whole sex ed agenda, that's been in place a long time. It's just getting more and more toxic.
Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to being at the conference, and I'm thrilled to be on today and talking about this. And we'll talk a lot more about it.
Well, yes, and I'm thrilled that you're coming, and we're going to give you an award. Every year at the Ruth Institute, we give an award for what we call the Public Witness of the Year. And we always choose somebody who's been in some way victimized or harmed by the sexual revolution and survived and is willing to talk about it, right? That's what we call a witness.
It's quite an honor to get that. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you.
I'm looking forward to it.
Oh, thank you so much for being on the show today, Walt. And thank you for all that you're doing. And I can't wait to see you in a few weeks by now.
Not very long. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and if you stumble on this video after the conference is over, just keep checking back, because the presentations from the summit will eventually be uploaded online and you'll be able to participate in all of it that way. So,
all right. Well, thank you so much.
Well, Walt Heyer, thank you so much. It's been a true pleasure and honor having you on the Dr. J Show today.
It's been actually my pleasure. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Matt Maddox, the Digital Marketing Director at the Ruth Institute. Join us this 24th and 25th of June in Lake Charles, Louisiana, as we fight for family. You'll get expert testimony based on solid scientific research. You'll get clear thinking. And you'll hear the stories of the survivors, all of which will empower you to protect your family and help your children and community achieve their divine potential. We can't wait to see you there.